Hello, everyone, and welcome to her experience with HSDD in her own words. My name is Dr. Marianne Brandon. I'm a clinical psychologist and a certified sex therapist. I'm also a fellow with the International Society for the Study of Women's Sexual Health, and I'm in private practice in Boston, Massachusetts. So today I'm going to be presenting to you a patient I worked with, Danielle. At the time of her referral, she was 41 years old, a heterosexual female, and she had been married at that point for 9 years, and she and her husband had one child. Danielle is an attorney. She was working full-time, and a gynecologist referred her to me. She felt that Danielle's hormonal profile was normal and that Danielle would benefit from a course of sex therapy because of her low sex drive. At the time that I met with Danielle, she reported having no interest in sex for several years, and she was quite distressed by that. She said she and her husband had stopped touching altogether, and while she felt that they had a strong marriage and she loved him, she felt that the lack of sex was interfering dramatically with their intimate connection. She was fearing for her marriage. She said, quite frankly, I love my husband, but I don't want to have sex with him. So before beginning my biopsychosocial assessment with Danielle, I explained a couple of things to her. One is that low libido, HSDD, is a very complex issue and often involves a variety of input from her emotional self, her relationship, her body, and her biology. There's quite an interplay with HSDD. And I explained to Danielle that basically if it impacts her in her life in any way, that variable could very likely impact her sex life as well. So we began the assessment with Danielle's emotional self. We talked about her stress level, which really was significant. She worked full-time. She was a mother and had a lot of responsibilities in her life. She also spoke about anxiety, particularly performance anxiety during sex. Thankfully, Danielle had no history of sexual abuse, but she did have an unpleasant sexual debut, which is something that we addressed in her therapy. And from a cognitive perspective, Danielle spoke about worrying about sex literally every day. And while trying to coax herself to fantasize, she wasn't having sexual fantasies. And during sex, she focused on her negative thoughts instead of embracing the sensation in her body and tuning into her body during sex. So from a relationship perspective, Danielle felt that her marriage was strong. She felt respected and appreciated by her husband, but she was very aware of the tension in the relationship and anger as their intimacy diminished and their connection, she felt, was suffering as a result. She was attracted to her husband. Her husband did have sexual concerns. He felt that his ejaculation was delayed, which we did address later in the treatment. Danielle spoke about religious messages that she felt were probably still negatively affecting her sexual experience. And from a biological perspective, Danielle was on no medications that we would expect to have sexual side effects from, but she did have back pain, and that interfered with her interest in sex. From a lifestyle and environmental perspective, Danielle was definitely sleep deprived. She was very clear about that. She did try her best to manage her stress, but it did get the best of her at times. And Danielle was conscientious about exercise, but because of time constraints, she wasn't exercising as much as she had wanted. And she was conscious, too, of nutrition and eating well. In her own words, Danielle identified many reasons for her low interest in sex. One was that her child was in the house, and she felt self-conscious about having sex with her child nearby. She spoke about the challenges of the dual roles of being a sexual woman and a mother. Her body image, particularly after giving birth, sustained a hit. And her husband, she felt, wasn't home enough. So she was very conscious of the lack of family time. She felt that impacted her sense of closeness with her husband. She was clearly stressed at work and sleep deprived. And that religious message of not having sex, she felt kind of like she talked about it as a bit of a dark cloud hanging over her sexual experience. Danielle clearly didn't have enough time for herself in her life, and she was feeling depleted. So Danielle met the diagnostic criteria for DSM-5, female sexual interest arousal disorder. And those criteria, just to review, are reduced arousal, reduced interest, reduced sexual thoughts or fantasies, reduced initiation and being unreceptive to a partner's attempts to initiate, absent or reduced pleasure in at least 75% of all sexual activities, and symptoms need to be present for at least 6 months, and they must cause distress. Danielle met all of these diagnostic criteria. So she and I developed a mind-body treatment plan, which involved individual psychotherapy and couples psychotherapy. I also referred Danielle to a gynecologist who specialized in sexual medicine for an evaluation for flibanserin. She was evaluated and was, in fact, placed on that medication. So I started with Danielle with basic education. We talked about the dual control model of sexual response, which was a model developed by scientists at the Kinsey Institute. It basically talks about sexual excitation and sexual inhibition factors kind of on a balance, on a scale. So on the one hand, there are those factors that would make Danielle interested in sex or further her enjoyment of sex. And on the other hand, there were factors that inhibited her desire or interfered with her enjoyment. So in our therapy together, we talked about balancing those in such a way that we minimized the inhibition factors in whatever way we could. Some of them weren't possible, but others were. But in fact, we spent quite a bit of time focused on excitation factors, how we could amp up her sexual experience. We talked about the fact that sexual desire could be spontaneous or could be responsive, not spontaneous, the way people often perceive it, quote unquote, should be. People often perceive that desire should just sort of come from the body and people should just want sex spontaneously. But in fact, so often, people's sexual desire is responsive, which means that when, for example, a partner initiates, a person can sort of respond and open and enjoy the experience. So Danielle and I talked about that as being a realistic goal for her. And we discussed the importance of her needing to want sex for herself, not her partner. If this was all about pleasing her partner, it was really unlikely that we were going to reach the goals that she had for her therapy. And so we started with, who did she want to be as a sexual woman? I wanted Danielle to have kind of an image in her mind and a goal we could work toward that was as concrete as possible about what we were doing together in this therapy. So Danielle identified these goals. She wanted to make sex intimacy a priority for herself and scheduling sex if necessary. She wanted to initiate sex with her husband and learn to communicate more directly about her desires as well as her boundaries, which she didn't want to do. But she wanted to talk more about, be more comfortable talking about what she did want to do, which actually at the beginning of therapy she wasn't entirely sure about. We had to sort of sort that out together. Danielle wanted to be responsive and open to her husband's sexual initiation, and she wanted to be a little more creative in bed. She wanted to be able to be comfortable trying new things and experiment a bit. What Danielle found most valuable about her sexual experience with her husband was the loving connection that they shared while making love. So we made that a priority as well, how she could enhance that sexual loving aspect of her sexual experience. And also helping her feel more embodied. She was aware of being so tuned into her negative thoughts. She wanted to, during sex, be more tuned into physical pleasure. So these were her goals and how she imagined what she wanted for herself at the end of therapy. So we started with the goal of embodiment. So that's basically helping her get out of her thoughts and into her body. And we did that from a variety of perspectives, both when she was alone, becoming more comfortable with those experiences, and also strategies for when she was making love. So when she was alone, I encouraged Danielle to get used to that experience of letting go and more comfortable with it. So that meant putting on some pleasant music and locking herself in a room privately and just sort of letting her body relax and finding pleasure in that letting go all by herself, just sort of like letting her body open. And we also talked about how yoga could also assist in that process of bringing her into her body and being focused and tuned into her body. So she began a yoga practice. She was very eager to do that, actually. And that sort of was a general reminder of how to feel her body and tune into her body. And then when she was with her husband, we talked about her learning to sort of relax into her partner, maybe letting go of that sensation of a boundary between she and her partner so that she could kind of let her body relax into him. She found that helpful, that sort of thought process. And she also used a self-coaching word, open, to help when she felt like she was distancing herself or constricting in some way. So what that meant is she just sort of silently reminded herself to open at times to bring her body back into a more receptive state. We addressed Danielle's negative thought processes, so both before sex and during sex. Before sex, when she would have negative thoughts, like she would expect that sex would be boring or bad, we talked about her instead switching her thinking pattern to an attitude of curiosity. Could she just be open to wondering what would happen as opposed to thinking negatively about what would happen? She found that to be very helpful. And then during sex, instead of getting focused on her weight concerns or performance anxiety, Danielle learned how to bring her attention to her breath and to physical sensation and pleasure. So basically back into her body instead of being focused on her thoughts. And from a perspective of enhancing physical pleasure, we addressed that both when for exercises for when she was alone and with her partner as well. So the question when she was alone that she needed to answer was what woke her up sexually, what made her sexually interested and excited. And the way she did that was she read erotica online, and she also accessed some porn made by women for women. And the key in this process for her was suspending self-judgment. So rather than looking at and reading these materials and judging them and determining what she thought was quote unquote appropriate for her, she was supposed to just tune into her body and let her body speak to her. So rather than judging what she was seeing and reading, tuning into her body's responses to learn what woke her up. Also a part of this process was masturbating, not to orgasm, but just to learn her body better so that she could teach her husband how she liked to be touched. And mindfulness meditation practice was also an important part of this process for her, so that she learned that experience of letting those negative thoughts kind of float by and not attaching to them, and instead bringing her attention back to her body. With her partner, they read technique books together, which they found sort of a fun thing to do. And we focused on improving their sexual communication as well. From the perspective of enhancing a loving connection, we talked about how they both could take some time before lovemaking to tune into their loving feelings, so that when they joined each other, they already felt tender. They were already in a place of warmth and sort of feeling a connection. We also talked about how they could communicate nonverbally really important information. They could be communicating a desire for their partner and love, or disinterest. So we talked about how they might shake hands with someone that they didn't know, or look at someone that they had no connection with, as opposed to how they touched and looked at people they cared about, and then being conscious of bringing those skills into their sexual situation. And from a couples therapy perspective, we talked about the emotional barriers that they felt interfered with their connection. So that was a variety of things. They had been married for a while, and all marriages accumulate that over time. We also talked about increasing non-sexual touching, like hugging and hand-holding, so that their bodies were kind of used to connecting and being together outside of the bedroom. We talked about a plan for sexual initiation so that they were a little more clear about how their sex life would unfold, and spending more time on foreplay to enhance their sexual arousal. Danielle's husband did address his delayed ejaculation with his GP, and they changed his medication, which actually helped with his delayed ejaculation. So in sum, Danielle maintained lifestyle changes over time. She recognized that this was going to need to be a kind of a lifestyle reorientation. So she agreed that full-time work meant 40 hours a week full-time and not more. She agreed to maintain her meditation practice, which was about 10 minutes a day, do yoga at least on weekends, and spend more dating time with her husband. So they actually took up ballroom dance class, which I thought was perfect for them because it gave them an opportunity to have some physical contact as well as date. So in sum, I followed a mind-body treatment approach for Danielle that involved individual and couples psychotherapy that was complemented by flibanserin. She remained on flibanserin at the termination of her therapy, and also, as I said, continued with yoga and meditation and dance classes. So at the end of her therapy, she felt reconnected to her husband. She felt quite joyful about that and enjoying intimacy again. So that's the end of my talk. Thank you very much for your participation.